As we enter into our worship this morning, we're going to do so with prayer, and we're going to ask Brother Aaron Simmons to lead our minds in prayer. Would you all please bow at this time?
Heavenly Father, we come to you now asking that our worship this morning be acceptable to you. Help us, Father, to set our minds on you, setting aside the cares of this world. Help us, Father, in all things that we may internalize the lessons we learn this day in spreading your word to those in the world. Be with us, Father. Help us to speak the truth in this worship. In your Son's most holy and precious name. Amen.
Good morning. Our worship this morning, the songs are going to be geared around our Heavenly Father and some of the reasons why we revere Him. So our first song is going to be in your blue supplements, song number 14, Awesome God. Notila our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
As we prepare to take the Lord's Supper this morning, I wanted to share a few thoughts from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, about the nature of the sacrifice of Christ. Verse 5 says, "Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Christ died on the cross. That was ultimately his sacrifice for us that makes possible the forgiveness of our sins. But notice that that's not the full extent of the sacrifice of Christ. In order for Christ to die on the cross, he had to be a man. And in order to be a man, he had to come to this earth. He had to leave heaven, come to this earth. And in order for his sacrifice to be effective, he had to live a perfect life, a sinless life. And so the sacrifice of Christ was not just dying on a cross. It was full obedience to God and working out God's purposes in the life that he had on this earth. You know, he left heaven, it says, came to earth, took on the appearance or the form of man. We might think, well, that's not so bad, right? We're all human beings. Life is good. Well, compare heavenly life with earthly life. Christ left a perfect existence to come and live a life of a man. We might say, again, well, not so bad, but can we imagine leaving our comfortable homes and just say, for 30 years, go live out on the street? That's going to be your existence. We would recognize that as a pretty big sacrifice if we were doing it for some noble purpose. But Christ leaving heaven and coming to earth was much greater than that we might contemplate as a sacrifice of ourselves. And again, as we said, in order for Christ's sacrifice to be effective, he had to live a perfect life. So he came, and it says he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. So his full life was a devotion to God. His full life was a sacrifice to God. His full life of sinlessness was necessary in order for him to have any effect of hanging on the cross, because a sinner dying for sinners would not be effective. And so, yes, Christ died on the cross, but there was much more to his sacrifice than that. And so as we contemplate the Lord's Supper this morning, let's remember the great lengths to which Christ went to make that sacrifice effective for us. And also let us reflect on the fact that we are to be imitators of God. We're to be imitators of Christ in our lives. And what does that mean? Does it mean just being willing to die for Christ if that were necessary? No, it means us leaving those things in our lives that we need to leave behind. We need to leave behind this world and live lives that are honoring to God. We need to strive to live lives that are like the life that Christ lived, dedicated to God, serving his purposes, being sanctified in our life so that our life can be effective in what God's purpose is for us. So let's think about these things as we now partake of the Lord's Supper. And with those that are going to assist, please come forward at this time. Shall we offer thanks for the bread? Our Lord, we are so grateful to you that you've made provision for us to be forgiven, to have a relationship with you, to be able to seek you and to find you despite our imperfections. And we're thankful, Father, and we know that it was because of the sacrifice of Christ that we have these things, that we're able to approach you, call you our Father, and to be viewed as righteous before you. So we thank you, Father, for Christ coming to this earth, living a faithful life, controlling his body throughout his life, that he might offer himself on the cross as a sacrifice for our sin. So now as we partake of this bread, Father, we pray that we might remember the depth of Christ's sacrifice and what we should be doing in imitation of him. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, great God, we humble ourselves with our hearts and coming before you. Father, please help us to remember his sacrifice and help us to follow his example and help us to remember his blood shed for us and help us to not to do sin anymore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Isaiah 64, 1 through 3. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, and that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence.
Our next song is going to be, again, in your blue supplement, song number 116, Only God. 116.
God with his great power. God with perfect wisdom, could my every need address. Give me food, a home and family, and a cool night for my rest. Only God could give us children, bless our lives with joy indeed. Who could hold a newborn baby? And if God still not believed, only God could send his own Son to my Savior, I a new life can begin. Only God in His great mercy could salvation grant to me. Only God could create
next song. Oh, I better go grab a book.
Be right back. Sorry about that.
Our next song is song number 5 in the large hymns for worship book. How great thou art. Number 5.
No, so, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the words thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great.
From lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the bird, and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, then sings my soul. How great thou art, how great thou art.
And when I hear that God is Son of Mary, sends him to die, I scarce can take it. And on the cross, my burdens gladly carry. He bled and
my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then this sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Christ shall come down with shout of acclamation, and make me whole. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall come in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior, come to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. I'm sorry, there was a prayer slide put in there when there isn't a second prayer. We can move on. In your red supplements, please turn to song number 36. Whom shall I fear, God of angel armies? If you're able, please stand for singing this song.
No soul.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Who shall I?
please, in your books, the song of invitation will be song number 205, Amazing Grace, 205. On April 18th, 2008, I was awakened a little bit early by a slight vibration. It seemed a little weird, and I jokingly thought, hey, this kind of feels like an earthquake. But I assumed it was probably just a big truck rumbling by, maybe an airplane that was kind of low or something like that that shook the house a little bit, so I just went back to sleep. I awoke later to find out, yeah, there actually had been an earthquake in Missouri, of all places, right? You know how y'all like to talk about the tornado that, you know, hit here however many years ago? That's the way I felt about the earthquake that I experienced. I know to some of y'all, this is just old hat. You're like, yeah, whatever, earthquakes, been there, done that. But unfortunately for me, even though the quake hit close to St. Louis, Missouri, I was actually doing a meeting in a town that was probably a couple hundred miles away. So whereas I kind of felt it, I didn't really feel the impact that the rest of the folks there in St. Louis would have felt. But I still continue to think about that. I mean, like I said, some of y'all have been through this, and you know what that feeling is. I really don't. And I'm not saying that I want, you know, to experience one of those ones that just does massive damage and that type of thing, but just to really feel what it is for the bedrock underneath you, what your whole stability, it is suddenly not there. And everything that you're on, how amazing would that be to go through something like that? Is it any wonder? And for those of you who have been through earthquakes and you know exactly what is under discussion, is it any wonder at all that when it came time for God to speak about and talk about who he is, that he just happened to use earthquakes to do that very thing? This morning, I want to spend our time focused on a concept of the power of God as he displayed it in crucial times throughout the scriptures. This morning, I want to talk about God quaking the mountain. Good morning. Boy, it's good to be here this morning, isn't it?
Amen.
Yeah, it's good to see everybody here together, to have this time to fellowship with one another, to sing these songs together, just to be here together. It is indeed a wonderful thing, and to know that we are together, as we talked about in our Wednesday class, as we are going through Hebrews on Wednesday, and kind of is the point of the bulletin article this morning, especially for those of you who are joining in with us online right now. We're not just physically together, but we are together in the Spirit. And we have access to the most holy place to go and worship God in the presence of God himself because of what it is that Jesus has done for us. And we talked about that in Hebrews chapter 10. So it's wonderful to join with all of you who are with us online, to join all of us here together as we worship God together in the Spirit. We have those who are visiting with us this morning. We're really glad that you're here with us. We appreciate that you have chosen to be here, and that makes us feel pretty special. We're glad you're here, and we hope that you will feel encouraged by the time that you spend with us this morning, and particularly as we begin to look at the idea of God quaking the mountains. Now, this idea really is demonstrated starting in Exodus chapter 19. We're going to get into 19 and 20. Exodus chapter 19, it says, it came about, starting verse 16, it came about on the third day when it was morning,
And there was thunder and lightning flashes, a thick cloud upon the mountain, a very loud trumpet sound, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was all in smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked violently. When the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him with thunder. Then the Lord came down on Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. Can you imagine this scene? What this must have been like for these people. They come out, Moses brings them all out to the mountain. There's these loud noises, there's the thunder, there's the lightning, there's this fire and the smoke that billows up into the heavens. There's this trumpet sound that's playing, that's getting louder and louder. And in the midst of this, the mountain quakes, the ground shakes. God is demonstrating for them right here who they are. You know, and it almost feels like maybe what a rock one of those really good rock concerts, just the noise and the vibrations and all of that. But even at the same time, God's not using cheap tricks. He's not doing various things like that. These aren't special effects. None of this is here for entertainment purposes. What is being witnessed here is the true and the awesome power of the great Yahweh. And just in case, maybe they might have missed it when God demonstrated who he was through the plagues in Egypt, overcoming, you know, having the great military victory of the death of the firstborn, all of that that took place. Or maybe if they might have missed it as they were coming out of Egypt and they crossed through a place that's impassable because of water, but they crossed through on dry ground and made it over. Or in case they might have missed it when God provided for them water, or he cleansed the water, provided for them food, provided for them water. And then, by the way, when they were attacked, he defeated the Amalekites for them. In case they missed all of these things that demonstrate who God is, God says, yeah, well, I'm going to show you this too. There is no mistaking just the awesome, terrible display of God's power and might. So much to the effect that when you get into the next chapter, chapter 20, verses 18 and 19, all the people perceive the thunder, the lightning flashes, the sound of the trumpet, the mountain smoking. When the people saw it, they trembled and they stood at a distance and they said to Moses, we're done. You speak to us, we'll listen to you, but let not God speak to us or we will die. They get it. They understand exactly what it was that God was trying to get across here as he is showing, he is demonstrating his true and awesome power before them. Remember, this is the whole setting of God creating his relationship with them. We skipped it when we got to verse 18, but remember, in this chapter, God gives them the Ten Commandments. And these are spoken by God from the mountain in such a way that they hear the Ten Commandments given to them and they tremble. And then in chapters 21 through 23, really the end of chapter 20, but basically 21 to 23 is what we have. We call it the Book of the Covenant. And this is kind of some laws that God basically details, gives out to them. It's kind of like a sampling of what the law of Moses in its total is going to be. And so he's giving them this little bit so that they can get a feel for what his law is and they can agree to the terms that he is setting before them. And they say, all that the Lord has said we will do and we will be obedient. And that comes in chapter 24 when they enter into the covenant. We talked about this actually in our Hebrews class as well. When they shouted, all the Lord has said we'll do, we'll be obedient. They took the blood, they sacrificed some bulls, they took the blood, half of it, They sprinkled on the people half of it. They sprinkled on the altar. In that way, they're joining two parties into a contractual agreement, into a covenant bond with one another, sealed with blood. And then through all of this, God is saying, this is who I am. This is who I am. This is the relationship that we have. Keep in mind, before this moment, Exodus chapter 24, before this moment, they are not a nation. Before this moment, they have a vague understanding of who God is. Before God leads them out of Egypt, they're just a bunch of people who know that God spoke to their fathers some 400 years ago, but he's been silent since then. But at this moment, when God gathers them together at Mount Sinai, brings them to the mountain, the same God of their fathers comes to them, and he does so with an incredible display of power. And the idea is to make sure they know exactly who God is. They're not on the same level as God. They might think that from time to time, trying to make decisions for him, challenging the decisions that he's made. But right here at the very beginning, God is very clearly demonstrating who has the supreme power in this relationship. And it rests with him. And he demonstrates this by making the mountain to quake, by making the lightning and the thunder to flash. God demonstrates this in such a way that it is absolutely undeniable. He is the one who holds the power. By making the mountain quake, by making the lightning, the flash, the smoke appear, he gives them a physical demonstration of who he is as their God. They got the point, sort of. For a little bit. I mean, about that much. I mean, you know, they really didn't. But here's the thing. God had made the demonstration for them. And so at some point, God was going to come back and talk to them again. Now, I want to move forward now to the time of Isaiah, the prophet. Now, let's set the context for Isaiah here, you know, real quick. Remember, Isaiah's writing about 700 years or so later. You know, he's a long time after Moses, after this time period. And he's speaking in the last section, once you kind of get to around chapter 40 through the rest of Isaiah, a lot of this is speaking about events that are going to happen in the future. And yet, when he does so, he speaks in the present tense often, as if what is happening right now is right now. But they understand he's talking about future events as if he is living them. And I think that's what's happening here at the end of Isaiah, really in chapter 63 through 66, the rest of it. He's writing concerning a time, really, about the Babylonian captivity, which, remember, is not going to come for over a century later. I mean, it's going to take a while for all of this to come to fruition. So when we read this, we need to be careful not to assume that even though it's written in the present tense, this is going on in Isaiah's time period, because these events are not. At the same time, we see that his look is that it's really based on the failures of Israel over the years to follow the covenant that was given to them in Exodus chapter 24. After time has passed, they've kind of forgotten that the mountain quaked before. And so we get into chapters 63 and 64 in particular. This is a psalm of lament. Again, written in the present tense. It's talking about future events. And these people recognize why they're brought to the point of lament. You know, if you were to read verses 15 through 19, they recognize they are indeed a sinful people before God. They know that they will deserve, or they deserve, whatever judgments God is bringing upon them. that they really brought it upon themselves. In verse 16, they know, that they're not the same as Abraham. In verse 17, they know that they are unrecognizable to Jacob. That they are so far removed from their fathers and who and what their fathers, their forefathers were, that God is just in any punishment he brings. They understand that they're not what they should be. They're not what their fathers were. And they understand God is not with them because of it. And then you come into chapter 64 and verses 4 through 12. Here in this section, they recognize their sinfulness before God, that any punishment is just on God's part. You look at verses 6 and 7, you may not know that it comes from here. Actually, some familiar verses to you. Verse 6, all of us have become like one unclean. All our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. Some of y'all probably are familiar with that phrase, and you've heard that before. All of our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. Verse 7, there's no one who calls you by name who arouses himself to take hold of you, for you've hidden your face from us. You have delivered us into the power of our iniquities, into the power of our sinfulness. Even our righteous deeds before you, he says, are but filthy rags. And, this is one of those phrases that you're probably familiar with. It gets a lot of mistreatment, I think, today, because it gets ripped out of what Isaiah is doing, and then it gets put into a conversation that was never supposed to have been in the first place. That idea of, faith versus works and that whole discussion. And so this gets pulled out and brought into the faith versus works discussion, and they say, you can't be saved by works because even your best works are nothing but filthy rags before God. And that, I don't know if any of y'all ever heard that before. That's how I've heard people explain that before. And that has nothing to do with what Isaiah is talking about here. When he talks, when he says that your righteous deeds are like filthy rags, he's talking very specifically to a covenant people who have left that covenant. They've rejected God. They've walked away from God, but they're still giving him some lip service. They're still doing righteous deeds, but it's not backed up by a righteous heart. And God says, that is repugnant to me, that you would go through the motions pretending and acting as if everything's okay, doing all these righteous things, when inside you're full of dead men's bones, when inside you are as far away from me as you could be. These are people who offer sacrifices and prayers. They go to the temple, they go to the feast, they do things that they're supposed to do, but none of it actually matters to them because they are sinful and reject their relationship with God where it really matters. They also worship other gods. They live in sinfulness. They treat the poor of the land with contempt. They take advantage of the poor. And when their lives say one thing about who they are, God doesn't want them to come to him with righteous deeds that say something different, as if it's going to make it different. Because those righteous deeds done by a heart that's unrighteous and doesn't care about God and God's covenant, those righteous deeds are nothing better at that point than a filthy rag. Literally here, feminine hygiene products. That's what filthy rags are, those that have been spoiled by women's menstruation. That is what this is talking about. That's the way that God sees these things. They're not genuine. There's no faith behind them. The people don't really care. And I hope you can maybe see a little application here for us. If we take on God's covenant for ourselves and then we simply turn our backs on God and do whatever we want to do, however we want to live, with no reference to him at all, it's the same exact scenario. Going to church on a Sunday morning, giving token prayers before meals, reading a Bible, specifically in front of others so they'll see it, wearing the cross on the necklace or on clothing or whatever it might be that is an outward demonstration to the world that says, hey, I'm a religious person and I want you to note that I'm religious. If those things are done by people who inwardly are not living their lives to the praise of his glory, inwardly people who are just doing whatever they want to do, they're paying lip service to God with these righteous acts that the world can see, but inside they're full of hypocrisy. Well, the acts that they do are no better than those spoiled rags. But if we are living for him, actually striving to do his will, actually striving to live by his law, sacrificing ourselves on the altar, that's not what Jesus is talking about. Those righteous deeds done by a heart that honestly, truly desires to seek God, those are fantastic deeds that are done in God's sight. Those are worthwhile. Those are indeed a fragrant aroma. And then you get to verse 7, you've hidden your face from us and delivered us into the power of our iniquities. Again, just very powerful. What they were going through was punishment that was brought on from God. In a way, it's a punishment, yes, but it was more than just them reaping the consequences of actions. God handed them over to the power of their sins, to experience those repercussions of their sins, to be destroyed by their sins. And then between 63:15 through 19 and then 64:4 through 12, you have this little section that was read just a few minutes ago in our hearing, Isaiah 64, starting verse 1. Oh, that you would rend the heavens, that you would come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence as fire kindles the brushwood, as fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things which we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. What's being called for here? Between these sections where they recognize that all the punishment that they're receiving from God, it's their fault, it's just, it's right, it's real, it's what God should be doing. But in the middle of this, they cry out to God and lament. And what are they calling for? Are they not? Is Isaiah not taking his readers back to Exodus chapters 19 through 24? Is this not exactly the picture of God coming down and quaking the mountain with the fire that's billowing up, the thunder, the lightning, the trumpet, all of that type of thing? He says, oh, would you do it again? If only you would do it again, come down and bring us back to the covenant. He says, come down, reestablish your relationship as the God of Israel. Come down and confirm again the covenant that you made with your people. Come down again and make the mountains quake, just as you did before when everything was set in motion that created the nation of Israel. They had left God. They had left the covenant. They'd seen what happens when God leaves them and lets them go into captivity. And now this is a part of the lament. It's a calling upon God for deliverance. How does God deliver? How does God bring them out? He rends the heavens. He rips them apart so that he can come down, make the mountains quake. Show yourself to us again. So here's the question. Did God answer that request when it was given? Did he split the heavens? Did he cause the mountains to quake again? Well, here's a little snippet from the prophet Haggai. Haggai, he's one of the later of the prophets. He's pretty late In the return aspect of things as they're rebuilding the temple. So we're talking about the second temple now, as the second temple's being rebuilt, and God sends Haggai the prophet to them. And in chapter 2, verse 5, as for the promise which I made when you came out of Egypt, my spirit is abiding in your midst. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once more in a little while I am going to shake or quake the heavens and the earth, the sea also, the dry land. I will shake all the nations, and they will come with the wealth of all the nations, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts. The latter glory of this house will be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts, and in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. Now, if you recall, as they're rebuilding the second temple, you know, those old timers that were really old by this point, and they remembered what that previous temple looked like, and they saw the foundation and they wept because it was nothing compared to what it was before. And then the young folks who are preparing it, having never actually seen the one before, they weep because they're doing this great thing for God. People are all weeping, and they're all together, and God, you know, comes to them and says, yeah, you know what, it's not as good. And I tell you, you know, he talks about the former glory, you know, and the glory that is going to come. Remember when they built the tabernacle, God came in a cloud and filled the tabernacle with glory. When they finished the temple, God came in a cloud and he finished the temple with his glory. And when they build this one, God says, you know what? I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. He's like, don't worry. You're going to build this up. I'm going to fill this house with glory. And so they finished building the temple, but there's no cloud. God doesn't come this time. You can keep reading, whether you're here or Ezra or whichever. There's no cloud that fills the temple with the glory of God, like the tabernacle in the first temple. It just doesn't happen. But God promised that he was going to do that when he shakes the heavens and all the nations and fills this house with glory. So what happened? Did they make a mistake? I mean, he promises once more, I'm going to shake the heavens, the earth, the dry land. I will shake all the nations. Well, where did he do this before? Again, we're going back to the mountain quaking, the mountain that quaked in Exodus. And what God is telling these people is they're going to see this request fulfilled. It is going to be quaking. The heavens will be rended. The glory that comes from it is going to be even greater, which means, I think, it's not going to be the same thing. It's not going to be a cloud that comes in and fills it. It's something greater to come. And what is that greater thing to come? Well, I'm glad you asked. Let's go ahead and let's go to Matthew and see what Matthew tells us about this. In chapter 27, starting verse 50, Jesus cried out again with a loud voice. He yielded up his spirit. Behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs were opened. Many bodies of the saints who'd fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. And even the centurion and those who were with him keeping guard over Jesus, when they saw the earth quake and the things that were happening, they became very frightened and said, truly, this was the Son of God. What is the crucifixion of Jesus? Or as Dave talked about earlier, his coming down out of heaven, taking on bodily form, emptying himself, pouring himself out to death. What is all of that if it is not God ripping the heavens open and stepping down into his creation? Remember when God did that the first time, caused the mountain to quake, it was to show the world, to show the Jews, the Israelites, who he is, so that God's people would see it, they would look at it, they would understand it, they would recognize the awesome power of God on display. Is that not exactly what happens here as well? When now it's not just the people of Israel, the centurion himself says, wow, you know, this was probably, he meant the son of a god. I don't think he was necessarily monotheistic. And there's nothing in the grammar that would differentiate between that. But he recognizes that this is a huge and powerful display that has taken place that's demonstrating Jesus is greater than any other criminal who's come through here and has died. And that is going to be even fully backed up by the resurrection that occurs. Let's look at some similarities that you find between Sinai and Zion, these two mountains. Both events, whether it be Exodus 24 or here, occur on a mountain, include wondrous signs. They both result in a covenant between God and his people, the old, the new covenants. Both include a fear of coming too close. Remember, as Jesus was going, he was abandoned by those who were in his following. Both involve one man who acts as a mediator for the rest, whether it be Moses or Jesus. But I think it's important that we notice these differences. Because at Sinai, God came in a cloud. At Calvary, God came in the flesh. At Sinai, God was not accessible. At the cross, God becomes accessible to everybody. At Sinai, everyone recognized who God is. At the cross, most refuse to then recognize who God is. At Sinai, the covenant showed just how sinful the people were, whereas at Calvary, sins are forgiven. Oops, I went too far ahead there. Understand this. God is with them. God in the flesh. And it brings us into this covenant to show us just how merciful God is. In Isaiah 64, there was a call for God to come again to establish, reestablish his relationship with his people. And having been written in the 700s BC, God took a long time to fulfill this request, but he does answer it. He took the lament at the end of there in chapter 63-64. He answers it with the greatest display of who and what he is that's ever been seen. No man can see God, but the only one begotten of the Father, he has revealed him. But even this isn't the end of the story, as I showed you the slide just a second ago. In Hebrews chapter 12, it comes up again. By the way, this is kind of why we're doing this. I'm saving Richard a little bit of time on what he's going to cover while I'm out of town, so he doesn't have to worry about talking about this section here. When you look at chapter 12, verse 18, the Hebrews author says to him, "You have not come to a mountain that can be touched, to a blazing fire, to darkness and gloom and whirlwind, to the blast of the trumpet, sound of the words, which sound was such that those who heard begged that no further word be spoken to them, for they could not bear the command, even if a beast touches the mountain, it will be stoned. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I am full of fear and trembling. But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the myriad of angels, to the general assembly of the church of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks better than the blood of Abel." The Hebrews author here is making the point that we've discussed, that Jesus dying on Mount Zion, it provides a heightened fulfillment of God meeting his people on his mountain. This mountain, Zion, it's a different mountain from Sinai. That old mountain, you know, they had to make a law that says not to touch it because you could touch it. It was there. It was physical. You could walk up to it. And you weren't allowed to. Even animals weren't allowed to stray into it. They made the prohibitions against that. But this mountain, Zion, is a spiritual mountain. It's not a physical mountain that you can touch. It's one that is accessible by everybody. There is no prohibition that's saying that you can't. Anybody who has been perfected by the blood and cleansed by the blood can come to that mountain, which, remember, we talked about on Wednesday, is the point that you get at in the letter to the Hebrews in chapter 10. If you're following the author's arguments in 9 and 10, you recognize that this mountain is the most holy place where God, the God of the new covenant, the God who brings the new covenant through Jesus, he provides access that the old covenant simply does not give. But the Hebrews author does not stop there. In verse 25, he continues, "See to it that you do not refuse him who's speaking. For if those did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape who turn away from him who warns from heaven? His voice shook the earth then, but now he has promised, saying, 'Yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heaven.'" This expression, "yet once more," denotes the removing of those things which can be shaken as of created things, so that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we receive a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. You know, as you study through Hebrews, you see just how logical he is with his use of the Old Testament scriptures. He'll say, "Hey, look at X in the Old Testament, because X, then Y." And he leads it through for us. He gives us the path to follow. And that's exactly what he's doing with Haggai's prophecy when God says, "Yet once more, I will do this." And just in case, he says, you thought that Haggai's promise was completely, fully, 100% fulfilled in Jesus, he says, "I want you to take note of the word heaven here as well, that it's going to be the earth and the heavens, that all of that is going to be changed." And so it's the heavens and the earth. And the point that the Hebrews author is making here is that God is going to, in some way, shape, or form, destroy all that can be destroyed. And then he makes a contrast between the first and second covenants. For us, he says, for those of us who are on the second mountain, the idea of destruction just doesn't really faze us. It's not that big of a deal, because we are on a mountain which doesn't shake, which doesn't quake. God doesn't do that to this mountain to demonstrate who and what he is. He doesn't do that to bring his judgment. As for Mount Zion, which is our covenant, it cannot be shaken. It cannot be destroyed. So ultimately, the Hebrew writer here is making a contrast of the first, the second covenants. But for us, hopefully we can see application, even though none of us, I don't think, are struggling between going back to the first covenant. We can see there will be a time in which this existence will be shaken a final time. There's going to be some point in history at which history as we know it and understand it ceases to be. There will be a conclusion to what we are in the way we're able to do it right now. See, smell, hear, feel, taste, the way that we know it, it's going to change in some way. And when that time comes, there will be the eternal that remains. As for the rest, our God is a consuming fire. You know, we talked about this on Wednesday. Our society likes to kind of point out or likes to think about God as this great grandfatherly figure in the sky. You know, and you know, he's just there. He's got, you know, the gray hair and all of that. And when we sin, you know, he's like, "That's okay. Come here. Let me give you a big hug. You know, that's okay. You go. You just, you be you. You do you. And I'm fine with that." and I'll give you a big hug and we'll all be okay. That's the way that our culture likes to think of what a loving God means and what that is. This is not the picture that the New Testament writers point. It's just not realistic. Sin matters. Sin is a big deal. Refusing Jesus, walking away from Jesus, rejecting Jesus, and going after the deceitfulness of sin, that leads to death. There is judgment that's coming. And even though our situation's different from what he's writing to, nobody here, again, is wanting to go back to the law of Moses to replace Jesus. This is just as applicable for us when he says, see to it that you do not refuse the one who's speaking, that you do not reject God, because our God is a consuming fire. Do not walk away from him. Do not reject him. Do not leave him. Do not forsake him. Hold fast to your faith without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Instead, let us show gratitude, by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe. A service in which the works we do are holy and pure and true, not like those that are done out of hypocrisy or lip service, which are not acceptable, which are simply like soiled or used feminine hygiene products. That's the best that those are. Our service must come from the heart, a heart that stays true to God. Then no matter what, because we know that our God is going to stay true to us, and in the end, when all else may be gone in some way, we will stand firm. Let us show gratitude by which we may offer to God an acceptable service with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Let's pray together. Our awesome, mighty Jehovah God, we thank you that you have rent the heavens, that you have come down in the form of man, that you have revealed yourself to us. Please help us to live in a way that glorifies you, and when that final shaking occurs, bring us into your glory. Through your Son, we pray. Amen. As we said, there are two mountains. Upon which mountain do you stand? Really, the question for us, because I don't think anybody here is tempted to walk away from Jesus and try to find your justification by doing the works of the law of Moses. So that's fine. Any other mountain that's not Zion is one that's going to be bad in the end. Where do you stand? We're going to sing a song in just a moment. I think it's a song you might be familiar with, Amazing Grace. And I don't know of too many songs that really hit the power of what it is that's given to us in God's amazing grace extended to us through his Son. You know, we talked about this on Wednesday night, you know, in Hebrews chapter 10, where he tells these people that they can draw near to God with confidence. He says, let us draw near, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. He's describing what happens at baptism, the moment when the outside, our bodies are washed with water. As Peter says, it's not cleansing the outside, it's what's going on inward as we are appealing to God for a pure conscience. Or the cleansing of the conscience in Hebrews chapter 10, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, contacting the blood of Jesus, having the blood of Jesus sprinkled on our hearts to have all the sin washed away, as we are outwardly immersed fully into water through the waters of baptism. That is how we enter into the covenant and begin the great journey, which will end on the great mountain forever with God. If you are here this morning and you recognize that that's not what you have done that you need to be baptized into the blood of Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you are ready to do that as we sing this song, simply come to the front, have a seat, and we'll assist you. If we can help you in any way, please come forward as we stand and sing for your invitation.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. I first believed through many dangers, toils, and snares. I have already come.
Thank you, Chris, for that lesson. Did the elders or deacons have any other announcements that need to be made? Not seeing any. Let's remember to be back this evening. Excuse me. And we'll be led in a closing word of prayer by Brother Kelly Hafer.
Father God, we are so thankful to call you Father. We are thankful for the times in our lives where you have humbled us gently. We recognize how powerful you are, and While we are grateful to be in a covenant with you through the blood of your Son, we realize that we do sin, and we ask that you continue to correct us gently, not in your wrath. Lord, we want to make you happy. Please help us to find ways this week that we can tell other people about your Son and the good things that he's done for us. We acknowledge how powerful you are, and we are humbled that you care about the things that bother us and concern us. And Lord, we pray that you will ease Miss Larson's pains and Brother Fussell's pains, and we ask that you strengthen our sister Alexa. We ask that you look after the Huntleys as they're traveling the next few weeks. Give them safe travels and help them to enjoy the time with their loved ones and bring them back to us safely. Please bring us back safely as soon as we can to gather together again and to worship you, to study your word, to enjoy the encouragement that we get from the family that you've given us here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.